Boom, boom. Yo, 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 yo. Here we go. This is the NRW where nerds rule the world. We are back in 2021 with Cobra Kai Season 3. Happy New Year. This made my new year already out the gate. Yep. I am Kuya P, and I got the big boy at Screamador. Bro! I'm excited, yo.
I am excited is not even a big enough word for this, man.
Yeah.
It was amazing. I mean, when everybody dies in the end, it's crazy. But
why are you spoiling it already? You're spoiling it already.
Okay. So, I mean, let me just say, just like what you said, Pat, man, it's like, you know, 2020 was not the best year for everybody, for everybody. But the way, I mean, thank you, Netflix, for starting the new year. Great for us. Thank you very, very much. You're getting my $11.99. Definitely, you know, you're getting it. I mean, you know, like I made sure, like I have people sharing my account. I message all of them. You better not be locking me out of Netflix. I will block y'all. I will change the password right now. Get off the Netflix, man. unless you pay me more money, you ain't getting none of this, man. So yeah, oh my goodness. Cobra Kai, writers, kudos. Executive.
Oh, yes.
Absolute kudos, man.
Salute to the crew, man. They laid it down, man.
I mean, the only people that can make 2021 better is that somebody gives me the vaccine right now. I mean, that's just such legit, man. That was so good. So
it was the vaccine I needed to start off 2021 without it being the vaccine.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's just a way to look forward to something. You know, you're like 3, 2, 1, happy new year. Okay. Let's watch Netflix.
Yeah.
You know, let's go Cobra Kai. Everybody leave me alone. Don't talk to me. Kind of stuff. So it was great. I mean, I loved it. I absolutely loved it. And then there was something in there for me as a Filipino martial artist. There's something that I'm going to throw in there when we get to that. But yeah, I'm definitely really excited about this. And I love the fact that the nerds are the writers in this one. The nerds are the people that the real fans, you can feel the love they have for this show, man. You can absolutely feel the love that they have for this show. So let's keep this going.
Let's get into it.
Yeah, let's get into it. So go ahead, brother. You start it off.
All right. Season 3, first episode out of season 3 was called The Aftermath. 2 weeks after the school fight, the Valley community is still shaking up and coming to grips with the consequences from the big fight that took over the school.
Right.
Sam is still shaken by the fight and is suffering from panic attacks. That's Samantha Russo, mm-hmm. Daniel's daughter. And then Johnny, who wants to visit Miguel in the hospital, can't because the parents, his mom's still kind of pissed off because of what went down. And when Daniel finds out that Robbie stole a van from the dealership, Daniel and Johnny, the most, you know, the team up we never thought would happen is happening. Daniel and Johnny Lawrence on a team up.
Oh my goodness. That was so awesome. So first of all, I mean, one of the things that they answered for me from the ending of season 2 at the beginning of season 3, it's like, you know, I said this in our review, like, there's no way teachers would have let them fight that long. You know, there's just no way, you know, the teachers would have been like, you stop that. But then the answer like, oh, you know, they're not allowed to get in between the students. And I can understand that, you know, the teachers don't want to get physically hurt also. So I can understand it. But still, man, I don't think they would ever let it go that long. I would have gotten the hose and started hosing people down, you know, kind of stuff. But yeah, it starts off with actually Miguel have this fictitious match in his mind, right? And of course, that's the symbol that symbolizes his new fight that he has to go through physically. Now, he was in a coma. We weren't even sure if he was going to wake up or whatnot, but it was pretty harsh. And of course, Johnny, you know, end of season 2, we saw him torch his car. I'm like, why would you do that? I don't understand that.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. I'm like, what the hell, man?
I'm like, why you torch your car? That was free, fool. You know, kind of. That was $3.99. I don't know why you torched that, you know? I mean, so he torched the car, and then now he was in a bar. Apparently he stinks, right, kind of stuff. And you know, and then he was just watching the news at the bar, but then somebody kind of stepped up and changed the channel, and then he tried to, you know, beat up the guy, but then he ended up getting beat up himself, you know, because he was drunk. He was absolutely drunk. They were even telling him that they wanted him leaving the bar already, right? So Johnny's definitely, you know, spiraling into depression, spiraling into a binge. You know, he's about to He's about to go to binge. I mean, he was.
I wouldn't say he's actually. Well, yeah, he was drinking, but I think he's mad at himself. He knows what he did.
Oh, for sure.
And for sure. Yeah, so. I think you got to be semi conscious when you do some dumb shit and you fuck around with two dudes that are bigger than you. Like, you know what's going
to
happen.
He wanted to get hurt. He wanted to get hurt. That's the thing. I mean, Johnny definitely could take care of himself. Exactly. But that was a psychological. I mean, I'm not no psychiatrist, but I mean, I think that was the thing. Like, you know, it's like death by cop kind of stuff. Like, he wanted to get punished. He wanted to punish himself with that one. I think that's why he didn't put up much of a fight. But I think what was so crazy was that, you know, he was already, he's depressed, right? He's spiraling, and he just didn't know who he was. But then at the same time, I think he's realizing the Cobra Kai way was not the right way anymore. I mean, that's how he lost his students he lost his dojo, he lost his students, and now he lost his only real friend. Let's face it, you know, Miguel was his only real friend, not just a student, but his only real friend that he has there. And he lost him, and now he's lying in a hospital bed kind of stuff. So I think that was a rude awakening for Johnny. It's like, maybe all this time he was doing it wrong. But then on the flip side, you hear Daniel saying, maybe I've been doing this wrong too.
Yeah.
Right. He doesn't want to teach karate anymore. He's like, oh man, all these kids got hurt. But then, and then he got to the point where the school was even like, they're enforcing stricter rules and everything. But I thought that was okay. So the funniest part for me, right? Karate means the way of the fist, right? It's supposed to be empty hands fighting, right? No weapons. Filipino martial arts, we start with weapons first and then eventually move to empty hands, right? So this is my biggest gripe. Why do they need metal detectors? Why do they need to be searching their bags? They only fight with their empty hands. I mean, I understand that they fought with them, but I mean, I get it. Tori had that claw, but karate guys don't fight with weapons mostly. They fight with empty hands, man.
That was kind of funny. That the post fight, you know, at the school, we're going to add metal detectors, but it had nothing to do with what went down.
They had no weapons. They had no weapons. And I don't understand. It's just like, no. I mean, you know, as a Filipino martial artist, you might want to check, you might want to check what I have that I'm carrying with me. I get that one I'm completely legitimate with. Actually, I just released a video last Friday about, you know, how I travel as a Filipino martial artist. I teach people how to fight with a scarf. So that, you know, because you can't carry a knife, of course, on a plane, you can't carry sticks on a plane, you can't carry anything that's metal really on a plane, you know, so I use a scarf. So yeah, I get that for on that end, but for karate guys, I'm not 100% sure that they really need to check the metal detectors and the weapon and the bags, because that kind of defeats the purpose. But I think, well, now that I'm thinking about it, I think that's one of the reasons why they were talking about the school board overreacted to what happened.
Yeah.
Right. They just said, I'm just gonna shut it down without.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, that's it.
Maybe it has something to do with that. So. Dang, these writers are so good.
Making me change my mind. Let's overreact to what happened. It makes sense for the rest of the episode and why they had to go and, you know, sit in front of the board in order.
Right.
But we'll get to that point. We'll get to that point. So what did you think of the buddy team up of our Daniel and Johnny? The writers love playing these two opposites together. What did you think of the kind of like towards the end of the episode of them coming together to try and track down Robbie?
Okay, because that's the thing. They both love this kid.
Yeah.
Right? That's Daniel's student, and that's, of course, Johnny's kid, right? So they both love this. So they, you know, and as teachers, and of course, I'm assuming, and you're a father, you know you got to put stuff aside if it's about your kid, right? You got to put stuff aside when it's about your kid. I've had students that want to go to seminars that I am not maybe a big fan of the instructor. I mean, as a person, but not their technique, their style and technique's legit. But my students are like, you know, we really want to go. I'm like, well, then you not that you need my permission, but you have my blessing, you know, and I will contact one of the people that I know running that place, who's still a friend of mine. I say, hey, man, so my students are going. I want you to keep an eye out there for them. You know, I'm willing to put that aside because it's what my students want. And, you know, as long as I feel they're safe, yeah, by all means, go. Right. If I don't feel they're safe, I will go with them. Just because I want to be there to, you know, shield them because of that. But for the most part, yeah, I got to put what, you know, the best, what's good for my sins, I got to put my feelings aside. So I love that team up. I mean, you know, the writers have always been teasing us with, like, are they ever going to be BFFs? Are they always going to hate each other? You know, I mean, it was, you know, it was over 30 years ago kind of stuff. But when they went inside the chop shop, bro, that was amazing. That was fun to see. That was really, really fun to see. They're fighting, you know, they're taking care of business. They're taking care of business. So I thought that was really, really cool. You know, and they just multiple opponents. That's the thing with multiple opponents. You can only fight one person at a time. I don't care what anybody says, right? And you know, those people like, wow, yeah, and then they block from behind them. That's not real. So what I found to be real in this one is, like, you know, they're fighting one guy and then they have to go fight another guy right away until finally it broke it down to one person. And then you saw Johnny lose it to that one guy who stole the van. Right. And then that's what broke apart the dynamic duo. And much shout out to Daniel's wife for calling them Tango and Cash.
That was a great 80s touch right there.
He's like, they're narcotics officers. This is completely different. It's like, you guys think you're cops now? Like, so I thought that was really cool. But yeah, that fight, them fighting together, was really, like, so badass, you know? Yes. I mean, as a martial artist, you know, we pray that we never have to use it, but, you know, sometimes we kind of want to use it, you know, on certain things. And then there's only certain social conventions where that's allowed, but that was definitely one of them. Right. Yep. And I love the fact that, you know, the difference between Daniel and Johnny, as far as the food is concerned, like, Johnny's like, I'm all about the gas station food. Right. Daniel's definitely not. So yeah, so that was really, really, you know, really cool. I love that they finally matched it up and they finally was able to take care of some business and trying to find Robbie. So
yeah.
Now I don't know. I mean, I'm not a car thief, but I don't know how many chop shops are looking for a 1993 Dodge Caravan. I mean, are they really still in high demand?
I know, right?
Are they still looking for parts for those things?
Yeah.
Whatever. So I mean that's just my little nitpicky point of by myself. So so all what right. do you think, brother?
Oh, it was a lot of fun, man. So let me bring it back to the episodes, because actually, sure, looking at what we were breaking it down, the when they encounter the thieves, that actually led us into episode two. So right. Let me talk about some of the elements that happened in sorry, episode sorry, two yes. that we can talk on. So yeah, the search eventually led to the pair to a group of thieves who stole the van from Robbie. So we talked about that. But also in episode two, FYI, the episode two is called Nature versus Nurture. Because right. a lot of times the title reads into what occurs within the storyline. So just FYI. Also in episode two, Johnny attempts to visit Miguel, but is rebuffed. And so funny moment there, you know, he tries to go in, he steals a doctor's uniform, but then when this dude comes out the toilet, he was like, nah, you don't work here. So he immediately sees that I can't do that. But then here comes crazy Johnny. He was like, okay, then let me bang my head against this metal air conditioner,
paper tower dispenser.
Yeah. And then he does that in order to, like, I need to see a doctor. And then the lady who rebuffed him earlier, because she wouldn't let him in because you had to be a parent. He's bleeding over onto the counter. So, okay, we'll go. We'll send you back or whatever. So that occurs. And we'll talk a little bit more on that. While that is occurring, Daniel finally finds Robbie at the rehab center and has the police take him into custody in order to lessen his sentence. So we'll get into that, and because that's going to be where Robbie's story goes along with this. Robbie was on the run. He gets found because of Daniel. But then that also leads to a distrust between Daniel and Robbie.
Of course.
And meanwhile, Kreese is back. And then there's some cool flashback sequences that's going to carry on through this season that we're going to learn more about Kreese, which is awesome. And Silver, which what I love, because that was a touch to episode or part three. But Kreese attacks Tori's landlord because Tori is now taking care of her mother since season two. Right. And in order to remove the repressure she has been taking on her, I'm getting all over the place. But Kreese attacks Tori's landlord because Tori's landlord tries to put the moves on her because they're not being able to pay the bills because her mom is ill.
Right.
And so the landlord is like, man, well, if you help me out, you know, because you're a young female.
Definitely, that guy was not cool.
So yeah, very creepy.
Creese, so I never thought I'd be rooting for John Creese.
Oh, I know, right?
in the series, and then all of a sudden he did that for Tori.
Yeah,
I'm like, yeah. There's somebody. This guy's definitely creepier. You know, this guy can't even keep his hands to himself, kind of stuff. And yeah. So I really never thought in a million years that I would actually ever root for this guy. But I was a little bit. I was a little bit.
And there's a little bit more that we'll get into as we go through this breakdown, because there's a flashback to his past as a kid. As a young high schooler, you know, working at this cafe or whatever.
Diner,
but
diner, yeah.
Yeah, at a diner. So let's just talk about with Johnny going crazy, smashing his head against that hand.
Towel the paper towel.
What do you think about that? That was kind of funny. And also kind of wild out.
I didn't right away caught the fact that he was trying to get into the restricted area.
Yeah.
I think it's also funny that he couldn't pronounce win. You know, it's like, I mean, like,
yeah,
how long
that
have you
was
in SoCal, bro? How long have you lived in SoCal? You still don't know? Okay, whatever. So that was kind of harsh. But until he went up to the thing, and I'm like thinking, you know, you're kind of beat up. You didn't need to bash your head into the thing. I think they would have seen you. And then especially when he showed the back. Remember?
Oh, I know. Like, oh, yeah. That was like, what the fuck? Yeah.
Whoa, dude. That's a huge hematoma. You know, I'm like, what the heck, man? So, and you know, so I thought that was kind of like, I'm like, okay, so he's really trying to get inside and see Robbie. And I can understand that. I can understand that, you know, and he's just
trying to understand Daniel's mom, not.
Miguel's mom.
Miguel's mom, yeah. I can understand him too.
If he's in the ICU, and maybe this is the Filipino side talking to me, right? Kind of stuff. It would have been a lot more. The restriction would have been that harsh, right? Because there's the thing about the ICU is there's other people, there's other patients there that might be highly infectious, kind of. Especially now we live in the COVID world.
Yeah.
So they would have definitely kept him out, kind of stuff, and there would have been a lot more monitors. If he was in the ICU, kind of stuff. But just so many things. But yeah, I mean, I understand why the need for him to go see Miguel to see if he, you know, if he's okay, kind of stuff. And to me, that was really, really important. I thought he was gonna go in there and just order Miguel to wake up, you know. He's like, wake up, you know, and then also he wakes up, kind of stuff. Yes, sensei, you know, kind of stuff. So
yeah.
I thought he was gonna do that, you know. So but you know, he didn't. And yeah, I completely understand where Miguel's mom and grandmother, our mom's coming from, but then the wise grandmother, the Yaya, right? She goes, you need to go in, you need to see, you know, in so many words, I'm paraphrasing like crazy, but there was like definitely saying like, yeah, you need to go see him. He needs you right now more than ever. And I think the Yaya understand that now Miguel is in the biggest fight of his life.
Mm-hmm.
And he needed his sensei to be right next to him to fight this fight with him. So I thought that was very, very important. So yeah, I love that. And of course, you know, the whole thing with Robbie, I mean, Robbie is just, you know, he's running, you know, he's running and he's, you know, he knows that he's in a lot of trouble. He knows he's in a lot of trouble and his, you know, that's the only thing he thought the best way to go is to run away. And I get that too. I absolutely get that. He's scared. He doesn't know what to do, but I love the fact that the LaRussos were trying to help him the best way they knew how. You know, they were going to get him a lawyer. They were like saying, okay, you have to turn yourself in because it's going to be a lot worse, a lot less worse than if they catch you because now there's no remorse there, kind of stuff. They could have probably told the judge, like, you know, he's a kid. Yes, he's a kid. So he didn't know. He got scared. I mean, yeah, he should still serve some time. So I thought that was really thing to do. And you know, and I really liked the fact to see, I thought that was really funny when they went to the rehab center to see Robbie's mom, right? That they're like, oh, so listen, so they thought that they were checking in Johnny.
Yeah, that was good. That was good.
See you in 28 days, Johnny, you know, kind of stuff, right? So I thought that was really good. So they finally saw each other and, you know, trying to get as much information as they can with Robbie. Now the prison scene, I thought that was really funny. I thought that was really funny in how they they basically intimidated the guy, right? And then, I mean, Daniel was intimidated until Johnny smacks him around and finally gave him the information that they needed. And the guards just kind of turned away, you know, kind of stuff, which doesn't make our prison guards look good, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, I have a lot of friends that are prison guards. So I can't really be on board with that, but I understand what the story was coming from. So I don't know. What else are your thoughts on that one?
So, I agree with all of that. The biggest thing with this episode was with Tori. Cause like I said, in season two, she was one of my favorite characters. I liked her whole arc. You know, she's had a lot of troubles growing up, found love with Miguel. You know, they became an item after, you know, Miguel and what's her name?
Sam
broke up. Samantha.
Right.
But then, you know, became kind of like a bad girl, became Cobra Kai or whatever. She stopped, you know, after last season, she wasn't part of Cobra Kai, was taking care of her mother, which I thought was great. But then you see the bad situation she's in with the landlord. And so then we get to have some feels towards Kreese, because Kreese helped take care of the situation.
Yes. Oh my goodness.
But, you know, I think there was a lot of good character building of her in this episode. Well, for, you know, first two episodes, but then she kind of stays the same way the rest of this season. So one of my big hopes that we'll talk about once we're done with this whole season 3 recap, one of the things I'm looking forward to is for season 4 is for Tori to come back full circle again, because now she's really a bad girl. And when we get to the finale, you'll understand why, but like, I want, you know, I feel for her because, you know, she has, she's just been through so much hell and she's still in hell. And now she's corrupted by Kreese because I got to give it to him because we felt compassion because Kreese helped her with her situation, but Kreese is a bad guy and is not good for her. So like, I want her to be good and I want her to still take care of her family and all that, but she's gotta, I want her out of that cycle. And if she stays in that cycle, she's going to continue to be, you know, a bad person. And I don't want her to be a bad person, you know?
I know. I completely agree. I just think that Tori has a little bit of, like, she feels like she has a debt to pay to Kreese.
Yeah. Now
maybe that's why she spiraled into more of the bad girl persona.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Kreese is the only one that actually did something.
Exactly.
You know, like he, you know, he said he'll take care of it. He took care of it, you know, kind of stuff. And it's just, I mean, cause definitely that guy's a creep, but then, you know, it was pretty bad. It was definitely pretty bad. So, but yeah, I mean, and then, you know, transitioning to episode two, we were talking about how that big fight scene in the garage, loved it. Again, I loved it very much, but then, you know, I don't know. What are your thoughts of that fight scene?
Oh, I thought it was cool. It was, again, great to see them two together, handling business. Love it.
Right.
So,
absolutely.
You ready to hit up episode 3 now? Now
let's
you're going to
pay? Let's do it.
All right. Now you're going to pay. In episode 3, Johnny solicits Bobby for advice and how to help pay for Miguel's surgery. So the Miyagi-Do students carry out a car wash fundraising event to help fund the surgery. But the Cobra Kai come out and Hawk, they steal the money from him. So that's not really cool. Also,
Miguel, so they knew that too. The kids told him that. Yeah.
So. Like, come on. Johnny reluctantly approaches Sid to ask for money to help pay for the surgery. And that was cool. Ed Asner. Good to see him get involved.
I'm glad he's still around because he's a real piece of work. So,
yeah. And what was cool? Well, we'll break it down into these elements. I'll just finish up with kind of like the breakdown, and then we'll get to the elements. So he asks Sid for money, but he's rebuffed. Johnny then resorts to stealing one of his statues to pawn it off for Miguel's surgery. Meanwhile, Daniel learns that his business rival Tom Cole has convinced Doyona Industries, gonna love that one when we get into that, to their business ties with Daniel, prompting him to visit the company headquarters in Tokyo. Towards the end of the episode, Sam then makes preparations for the Miyagi-Do students to fight against Cobra Kai. Robbie has a rough acclimation at his juvenile detention center and feels abandoned when Johnny reluctantly stays with Miguel for a longer period of time than needed. So let's break all that down in episode 3, man. Funny thing at the first thing for me, the funny thing at the car wash, you have, you know, young teens. They see all these, you know, beautiful women, car washing this one car. And so these young virile,
these young bucks,
they're like, oh, these yes, like, let me yes, get that car wash. But instead, when they pay for the car wash, they have some of the younger male students wash the car.
Much
that was hilarious.
This big boy, I think that was great. I think that was hilarious.
Yeah,
kind of stuff. They're like, wait, we wanted. Oh, dang, you know. So it's like that was cool. Like rubbing his box. it was hilarious. I cannot watch this. I can't.
As he was rubbing against the windshield, that was
right.
Like, okay.
Exactly. Absolutely. So it just kind of, I mean, you know, I'm just like, okay, that's what they got to do. You know, that's what they got to do. So yeah, just, but they went out of curve.
So just a big rivalry between the Cobra Kai students and the Miyagi-Do really would happen. And they then take it, you know, Hawk is still wilding out. And they take it to one of the Cobra Kai students, I mean, Miyagi-Do students at his job. He works at kind of like a Dave and Buster's, if you will. Yeah, and then they come jack him at his work. And so, you know, the Miyagi-Do students are having a very hard time and Samantha ain't feeling it. So, you know, she's like, well, we'll go get at him. So just a lot of that. And then outside of that, you know, Johnny wanting to also help pay for the surgery. What do you think of all of that with Johnny going to the pawn shop and they tell him, man, you ain't got nothing that's worth anything. So just again, Johnny and, you know, just how he's living it. But then this he goes to, who is Sid to him again? Was that like his dad?
Stepfather. His stepdad.
Oh, okay. I got confused at that point.
Right. No. So they were talking about how, you know, like their mothers, and this is where Johnny and Daniel had a connection, right? Where because like, you know, Johnny's dad is out of the picture. His stepdad's a piece of work, right? Yeah. And then, of course, Daniel's dad passed away when he was a little kid, kind of stuff. So, and then their mothers did what they had to do to survive. Johnny was talking about his mother married a rich guy so he can do something, you know, give us a better future. And Daniel's mother moved across country to give them a better future. And, you know, the two father figures that came into their lives was Mr. Miyagi and John Kreese, right?
Gotcha.
And then Johnny goes, yeah, well, your teacher didn't try to kill you. Well, there is that. There is that. So there's that. So, I mean, so that's how they're, you know, when I do my videos for 413 Media Group, I like to hear the story of the journey of how they became martial artists. What people relate to is the person's story. Like, hey, I'm going through the exact same thing. You know, I want to learn from this guy because he understands my struggles or he or she understands my pain, you know, kind of stuff. So that's why that was a really nice connection. It's funny again, because Johnny shows off how much he lives in a time bubble. He said, when the guy said, did you charge your laptop? You said it was wireless, you know?
That was good. That was good.
Poor guy. Yeah. But then he said, you had nothing, you're worthless. And again, he just kind of sprouts into his, into making him feel, you know, inadequate. Right. But he had to do what he had to do. He had to help Miguel. He wasn't going to give up. So he swallowed the big, you know, the big pride and went to his stepdad and asked for some money. And then he said that, oh, you need my money. He's like, I could take about, like, you think I got to where I am because of my reputation? Ha, 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 ha. You know, so he definitely, he didn't care. He absolutely didn't care. So not that I condone stealing, but I understand. But when Johnny grabbed that statue, and was like, all right, we're pawning this. We're pawning this. So, he's trying to save. He's trying to help Miguel and his family, kind of stuff. Like, instead of the mom going into super huge debt, kind of stuff, you know, that was very, really, really cool of him to do that. And then Sam, I could totally tell she was going through some sort of PTSD.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, completely. You know, what it was.
Yeah, she couldn't go to the first day of class, right? She snuck out and went to the dojo, the Miyagi-Do dojo, just had an in and out. Now I'm hungry. Thanks a lot, Sam. But, I'm sorry, you guys don't have that over there, but it's awesome.
Hey, okay, hey. Now, West Coast, East Coast.
you could totally tell she's like, you know, absolute PTSD kind of stuff. And then she was trying to, like tough it out. You know, she was trying to tough it out, telling the guys, yeah, we need to fight these guys back. But in the big fight scene at the laser tag place, you see her collapse. Yeah. You see her freeze. You see her kind of compress into a fetal, almost in a fetal position, right?
Yeah.
And then with Eli, that's a kid's name, right? And Eli used to be BFFs at the, you know, season one.
Yeah.
You know, these were the nerd kids that Miguel hung out with. He breaks his brother's, his friend's arm. I mean, that's just, and you know, mm-hmm. it takes a lot of effort. It's really hard to accidentally break somebody's arm. It takes a lot of effort to break somebody's arm. So it's hardcore. It's hardcore, absolutely hardcore. And he wanted to prove himself because there was new Cobra Kai's coming into the picture. He was trying to prove that he's still top dog, right?
Yep.
But, man, that was harsh. And you saw Sam just kind of collapse, right? And then, now, luckily, she was the one who probably took Eli to the hospital.
Yeah.
Her mom comes out pissed at her, and then she just breaks down.
Yeah.
Absolutely breaks down. And of course, the mom instinct kicks in and just kind of, okay, I'm here to protect you. And, by the way, I've always had three rules in my life. Okay, the three things that you never mess with: Mother Nature, mother-in-laws, and mothers. Okay, because there's nothing more dangerous in nature than a mother protecting her cub.
Yep.
Period. Right, and that's what happened. Yeah. That's what happened, because now what did Daniel's wife do? Go to Greece and slaps him. Slaps him. Yes. And I'm like, dude.
That's that was good too. I love that. That was really cool.
Scared. You know, I don't know if I don't care if I know karate. I know crazy. You know, because I'm like, she slaps him. But that's what a mom does.
Yeah.
That's what a mom does. And she couldn't stand it anymore. She just couldn't stand it anymore. So
yeah.
So Sam is definitely she's in a crossroads, and then all of a sudden, when she said she didn't want to do karate anymore, not because she didn't want to do karate, but I don't think she felt worthy of it anymore.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts?
Oh, I'm with you on that. And I really love the evolution of the mom character, Daniel's wife. Yes. I'm trying to find her name real quick, but I couldn't find it out the gate. Actually, we blended into episode 4 and 5
from episode 3,
which is all good. You know, we're just having fun. We're having fun. And actually, let me go ahead and bring in 4 and 5, because, you know, we've kind of went into it already. But I will add to this that 4 and 5, these particular two episodes are my favorites within this season, because as I'm getting ready to say, we go to Okinawa.
Yes.
And as you all remember from me and Big Boy, part 2 is our favorite of the series. So for them to come back to it, you know, I was going to love it. And so let me break down 4 and 5, and then we'll get back into kind of our fun convo with some of the elements within these episodes. But I'm with you all the way, brother. So episode 4 was called The Right Path. Daniel is rejected by Doyona. So he travels to Okinawa, Mr. Miyagi's hometown. So throwback to part 2. Johnny tries to reconcile with Rob. Meanwhile, Johnny tries to reconcile with Robbie, who is on community service, but that doesn't go well. And also during this time at school, Hawk instigates the fights with the Miyagi-Do students, which is, you know, like I said, we already kind of got into that because it bled into these. There's all these different stories going on at the same time. So we apologize if we're all over the place. No worries. So now Daniel visits in this particular episode. Daniel, like I said, he travels to Okinawa. He visits Tomi Village because what led to this, him going there was when he fails at Daiona.
Right.
The bartender. I forgot who says it, but somebody at the bar was like, because he's having a drink, is like, you know, people come to Japan, which just made me, and if you remember, this is part of what I love about our culture in Japan. Like, you may not find that person, but you can find, do you remember what she said? He said,
I can't remember the verbatim, but basically what the bartender was saying was like, you know, I would love to visit him again or something like that.
Yeah.
He's like, that's very American of you that you think that you still can't.
Exactly.
That was the thing. Yes. It's like, that's a very American of you to still think that you can't. So that's when he's like, well, then I'm already here in this part of the world. Let me go to Okinawa. Right. And he was very excited about it. He gets to Okinawa, he gets a taxi, and he gets to Tomi Village.
Yes.
And then now it's
a mall.
Gentrified. It's a, mm-hmm. it was gentrified. It's a mall. It had Starbucks. It had, you know, it had Jersey Mike's kind of stuff, right? So yeah.
You're on the Subway, we have a Jersey Mike's.
I know, exactly. I'm like, what? By the way, I like Jersey Mike's better than Subway because I had food poisoning there once.
Same. I'm with you on that.
Yeah. So, but yeah, so, I mean, he was there and he's like, what happened to Tomy Village? And he said, well, Sato, you know, like the all this stuff happened. And also he brought, he changed the infrastructure, he changed the economy, local economy, and it gave people jobs. Which mad props to Sato, you know, he's just doing his thing, you know,
mm-hmm.
Matt, you know, old man Sato. So that was pretty cool. But we have to talk about this. Yeah. That when they were doing these beautiful dances on stage, and then the teacher, the one whose back is to the audience, right? You know, I'm like, is that her? Is that her? I think that is her? And who was it? Who was it, Patrick?
The reintroduction to Kumiko.
Kumiko.
Loved it.
And she was exactly, almost exactly the same as, you know, very. And then that when they locked eyes on each other, it's like this giant smile that came about. And then, you know, and now one of my predictions that didn't happen, right, was that I thought maybe, and this was a wild prediction, but maybe Kumiko and Chosen got married. Clearly that didn't happen. Okay, so I'm sorry. I failed on that one, but that was just wishful thinking on my part. But I love that thing where she was saying, like, how come she never got married? He goes, because nobody else popped into death for me. And I'm like,
that was such a great line. I was like, oh. Yeah. And I love the flashbacks that we got to as he throughout the episode, like to reconnect with part two. He starts flashing back to what it looked like before, and now it's this mall. But then he sees Kumiko and the flashbacks to their relationship. Just
right, seeing her dance for the first time. Just, you know, that was perfect.
Perfect.
Exactly. Yeah. And then when they were having like tea, right? They were talking, and then you know, Daniel was still feeling really lost. So he wanted, and then he's like, I would love to talk to Mr. Miyagi again, but you know, and then Kumiko goes, oh, I can help you with that.
Yes.
And they go to, what's her aunt's name again? The Mr. Miyagi's, you know, flame.
Oh, yeah. I don't see it in my notes over here.
Hold on, let me look. Mr. Miyagi's girlfriend. There it is. Yuki. Okay. Yuki. So they get there, and then Yuki, you know, Mr. Miyagi already said this when in Karate Kid 2, that Daniel was going to get the house in California while Yuki was going to get the house in Okinawa. And apparently that's what happened. Like, you know, so Daniel goes, yeah, Yuki, this is Yuki's house, right? And who now, of course, now gave it to her niece, which is, you know, Kimiko, right?
Yeah.
So he gave her the house. And then they found the box of love letters.
Bro. Mr. Miyagi,
the player. Holy crap, he's a pimp. Dude, he's a pimp. That was so awesome. So he's like, oh, man. And then it's like, I read that from what was that one line that she said? It was like, I you like that? I got that from a car salesman. I'm like, oh, man, was he referencing to Daniel? You know, it's like, was he already at the car dealership at that point?
Go ahead. No, I just loved those touches. It's those little touches, like you were saying.
Yes.
That just, they, and it filled up so many holes too. Like even little side stories that we had lingering, they came back to it and resolved it. That's just brilliant writing, man.
Right. Yeah. That's brilliant writing. And then when Daniel was looking through the box of letters, he saw the letter that was written on the week that Mr. Miyagi died. Like it brought him right back. And then that letter brought him. I know that, I mean, my eyes were not, I wasn't crying. My eyes were sweating. I don't know what you're talking about.
I was crying. I ain't gonna lie. Yeah. I'm sensitive as fuck nowadays.
I was like, I can't do this at 3 a.m. Dang it, you know? I can't start 2021 crying, you know?
It was real. That was a great moment in this series, and just how much Miyagi,
there was
so beautiful.
So, I mean, unfortunately, I can relate to Daniel because I lost my teacher in 2004.
Yeah.
And in my I have a little, you know, like memento box where my teacher's wife wrote me a thank you note because saying that, you know, I really love the poem that you shared at your, you know, at his funeral. And then she wrote that, you know, she really believed in you. He really loved you. And I that letter is the most important thing, one of the most important things for me. Unfortunately, I only have one photo of him and me together. And that was like before, you know, high quality cameras was around kind of stuff. But it's what I have. It's what I have. And I'm just grateful for it. But yeah, I mean, it's just, it's, you know, that, you know, it's like when you have a teacher that means that much to you, that just means that much to you. It's almost like there's a piece of you missing. And every time you teach, you can't help but think, how would he do this? Right. And then, and when Daniel, I mean, you know, in Karate Kid 3, when he was lost, Mr. Miyagi was the one that helped him find his way back, right? Keeping that balance. And he needed Mr. Miyagi more than ever. Yeah, Mr. Miyagi, just like what that bartender said, it's very American of you to think that you still can't go to him.
I love that line.
And so I think they should make t-shirts of that. So Will Smith, you know, Karate Kid, Cobra Kai people, that's the next t-shirt.
Yeah,
that's the next t-shirt, right? That's the next t-shirt.
All right, so let me get into episode five now, because again, we kind of already went there already, but just for the next phase of this whole Okinawa trip. So the fight that we had happening at one of the Miyagi-Do students, Chris, he was being harassed at the golf and stuff. So we've already discussed that. So he was getting harassed there by Hawk. And then we have the whole fight at the amusement park with Samantha and her having the panic attack. Eli breaks Dimitri's arm. So that all occurred in episode five. So while that's occurring, Daniel now is still in Okinawa. Daniel and Chosen are met because of Kumiko.
She
surprises him with Chosen coming in.
Chosen, right. So I love the fact that, okay, so let me just break this down really quick. Okay. When Chosen walked in there, he still had that stern face, and then Daniel was in fight mode, right? And then now Kumiko, this is where I'm like, she was like, oh, he's here. I didn't know. You know, he had that look like, what's he doing here, right? And then so we go, of course, to that episode where now, go ahead, break it down some more, brother. I'm sorry.
So I just love that she fucked with him. And then we get to understand why, which is just so brilliant.
It was so brilliant. It was absolutely brilliant.
Daniel and Chosen are now, you know, Kumiko has to go do some stuff. So she kind of sets them up. Oh, I didn't know. But sets up Daniel and Chosen to go do that thing. Take him around Okinawa to see how
I love that he goes, I got errands to run. It's like, you know?
I love her character so much. But then I'm kind of sad because that we only got her a little bit. So, but we'll get into that.
But it
paid off, though, because we loved this, though. We got to see them two come together, Chosen and Daniel.
Oh, I know. So, but hold on. Just for Kumiko's, she was the one that gave that letter to Daniel.
Yeah.
Right? She was the one that reconnected him to Mr. Miyagi, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So she still played a very, I would have loved to see
very pivotal part.
Very, very, very pivotal for this. So, but yeah, so now it's Chosen, and Chosen's like, you know, like, I'm indebted to you. He's like, no wife, no kids. He's like, oh, you're living a free, you know, like, it's the best life. You know, so he was like this very stoic, very like grizzly kind of guy. Like, he's like, get off my lawn kind of guy, right? So, and then they go to like this beautiful like view of Okinawa. Like, this is the Okinawa I remember, which is true. That's great. And then they go to his dojo. Now, sorry, but Daniel, that was a dojo, man. Did you not see the mats? He was like, this is a dojo. No shit, Sherlock.
Yeah, that was kind of like, what the hell's wrong with you on that one?
I mean, you've been doing karate most of your adult life. You didn't know what a dojo looked like? I mean, he's like, why is there mats on the ground? Why is there, where's all these paraphernalia? Oh, it's a dojo. Yeah, I was like, no, bro. But I love the fact that, and this is really, I love this. Yes, there would have been a very big, I think there would have been a very big difference in the way Chosen and Daniel's karate would have evolved, right? Because Chosen had access still to the old stuff that that his uncle taught him. And of course, you know, Sato, you know, he trained so much, and then, you know, Daniel was trying to justify why Mr. Miyagi didn't show him that, right?
Yeah.
Was trying to justify that he didn't show him that. But, you know, whatever the reason is, that's Mr. Miyagi's choice, right? It was really great to see that Chosen continued with karate.
Yeah.
And Chosen still, and he got good with his uncle. Yeah. You know, he got good with his uncle. So I love that. So that definitely solved one of the questions that Karate Kid 2 did not, that left us hanging a little
so
bit.
I was so happy with that. I just love that. And we'll go even more into the whole sparring sessions they have and then the parting gift. But what led to that parting gift, though, is just, here's where I'm like, Daniel, what the fuck is wrong with you? Like, it was very disrespectful. Like,
oh, it is very disrespectful.
He was going through the shit and he thought,
fragile.
Oh, just because I knew Miyagi or whatever, blah, that I have a right to it. No, you don't, bitch.
No, you don't.
Come on, bruh.
No, you don't.
So it just made the later sparring stuff into the eventual later parting gift so much more beautiful. So why don't you talk into that, about that whole sparring and then the gift and just that fight, though, that I was happy to actually see Chosen. You know, he's come full circle now. Daniel's Daniel.
Right.
But, like, to me, this stuff started with Miyagi-Do and Miyagi and his family and Sato and Chosen to get that win in. He got that win in, bro.
He did.
And then I thought it was a student. Daniel, to me, it was like, Daniel still had more to learn. You never stop learning. While you may you think never, you're okay, already so there, you're not there. And he was ignorant. And Chosen put him in his place.
Yes,
it was beautiful.
Yes. As a martial artist, I will tell you right now, if a martial artist ever tells you that I know everything, then you know absolutely nothing, right? Let me just put it this way. Like, I always tell this to my students, right? Like, there's how much knowledge do you have might be able to fit in the shot glass, right? If you're just starting with me, all the knowledge of FMA you have might fit in a thimble. When you start training with me, it's a shot glass, then it's a big cup. Then it's a big gulp, right? And maybe I have a bucket full. I mean, I have like a sauna full. I mean, like a jacuzzi worth of knowledge, right? Well, my teachers have a swimming pool worth of knowledge, right? And then their teachers might have an Olympic size pool knowledge, right? But here's the thing. You know how much knowledge there are out there? It's the fucking ocean. You will never, ever learn enough. You will never, ever, ever learn enough. And so the evolution of Chosen and Daniel, and maybe this is the reason why Daniel never learned it, because Chosen didn't use those techniques during their life and death match. Maybe because Sato didn't felt that he was ready, right? Maybe I'm guessing here. From a teacher's point of view, there's certain techniques that I don't show my students because I don't think they're ready for it, right? Especially when I throw the fireballs and the levitation, they're not ready for that kind of stuff yet, you know. So, well, one day,
show the Street Fighter techniques.
Exactly. Hadouk, and then, like, you know, the Kamehameha, you know. So kind of, anyway, so, but yeah, so I think that the evolution of them definitely diverged. The big difference, of course, now, why Chosen now is way leap years ahead of Daniel's son, right, is because Daniel doesn't have Mr. Miyagi anymore. He had no other access. And even though that was rude, that's why he ran to that artifact, because that was like, I needed that connection. I need that tactile connection, right? While Chosen, of course, he trained with his uncle till his uncle died. And his uncle trained with Mr. Miyagi's dad, the original Mr. Miyagi, right? Into that, right? And so then now, I love the fact that Chosen was now talking more about history. Of what they're doing, and they started training with the bow staff kind of stuff. So that was really, really cool. And then finally, we see Chosen is like, okay, time to level you up. Time to level you up. And, you know, he just, you know, and then he started doing, you know, nerve punches, like he, you know, deadening the nerve, and all of a sudden he had three of his four limbs were all of a sudden numb. And then Chosen finally got his revenge, right? Live or die, man. Live or die. It's like, no. I got you. Your face. And then finally, we got him to see him laugh. I'm like, okay, you're not completely dead inside. I love it.
It was so brilliant, man. And you and the setup was there though at the on that mountain peak, looking down on Okinawa. Daniel said something very ignorant, thinking that he knew everything.
Yes,
and he didn't. Exactly. And then right there, boom. I just love that evolution again that we talked about with some of these characters. And we saw that with Chosen, and it was so brilliant.
It was so brilliant. And I think also that closed the story between him and Chosen.
Yeah.
Daniel and Chosen's, like, their story kind of went full circle.
Yep.
Right. You know, Chosen now he's a respectable teacher, right? And he took, you know, and then I don't know if he took over his uncle's business. He definitely took it over his uncle's school, but not his uncle's business. I don't know. So that part I'm not 100% sure on. But I love that they finally were able to, and that, you know, Daniel said, I wish all rivalries ended like this. You know, because of course he's giving a shout out to Johnny on that one, right? But yeah, it was such a beautiful thing. The fight, the them training was absolutely legit. You know, they're, you know, the you know, like making his arms go numb. Yeah, those are the spots. I'm like thinking of, you know, the inside part of the arm, you know, that kind of stuff, right? Those are the spots, you know, the thigh kind of stuff, you know, that those are the spots. So I'm like, that's legit. These guys did their research. Now, I'm not a karatista. I'm a Filipino martial artist, but I know some of these spots, right? And those were it. Those were some of the spots that I recognized. So I absolutely love that. And of course, let's talk about the scroll that he finally gave Daniel, right? And oh, I'm sorry, I have to take it a step back. When he deadened his arms and leg, he goes, "Teach me."
Yeah, exactly. I love that.
Teach me. And I'm like, finally, you know, so Daniel goes, all right, now he's leveling up, right? And then that scroll was, again, he goes, please put this part of your dojo, right? And then this, it really is important. I mean, just like I said, for me, that letter from my teacher's wife means the world to me. The scroll, that's, you know, that's touching the history of you, you know, that's touching the history. And I love the fact that Daniel said, we're like karate cousins. You know, and they are, and absolutely, they are absolutely karate cousins. You know, they're from the same lineage, the same technique, and the same mindset, you know, kind of stuff. So they're absolutely karate cousins. And now they're the two people whose job was to propagate Miyagi-Do karate, right? So that to me was absolutely really heartwarming.
Oh, yeah.
Really touching. And then finally, Chosen is no longer the bad guy in our minds. Yep. He was a good guy. He is, you know, he finally redeemed himself, and he redeemed himself to the Karate Kid and Cobra Kai fan base.
Yep. Love that arc of his character. So beautiful. Right. So let's break down the rest of episode 5, man. We still got a little bit more.
Of course.
So as he was leaving out, Daniel later meets, and this blew my mind.
Yes,
blew my mind. And I was like,
the moment I saw her face, I'm like, she looks. You're so, in. Oh my goodness.
He meets an adult Yuna. Who is Yuna? Yuna was the little girl he saved from the typhoon. The one that
was the real hero, Karate Kid, right?
She has now become the vice president of sales
for the Yuna.
Where he had just came from to, you know, hopefully get that happen and help Daniel with the dealership. So the fact that they brought her back was, wow.
I love it. I'm so grateful that they brought her back, because she was such a small character, but a pivotal character for Karate Kid 2. And then she's like,
She was the hero in part two.
She was the hero again. And then, you know, I mean, she probably had, like, when I remember in Karate Kid 2, she was like saying, you know, like, thank you for dancing with me. He's like, thank you for saving my life, you know, kind of stuff. And you know, she never forgot that. You know, and then as soon as I saw her face, she's like, you know, and I'm like, that's why I hurt my throat a little bit on that one. I'm like, oh my goodness, this is her. Oh, and she mentioned Dayona. Of course she does.
So good. That was so good.
You writers, you guys are crack dealers. Damn you.
I'm telling you, man. Yeah, episode 4 and 5 were my faves.
They were
that goes down. Robbie is, you know, in doing community service. He gets into a fight with that bully, who's bullying him. So that goes down. But one of the other key moments in episode 5 is Johnny helps Miguel with his rehabilitation. And that's pretty funny too. The whole Playboy thing, you know, burning his feet. That was hilarious. Great moments.
Exactly. It was Sports Illustrated.
But what they finally do is he takes Miguel to this concert, heavy metal concert, or rock concert, not really heavy metal.
It's a rock concert, yeah.
But D. Snyder, I want to rock. He takes him to that concert. And funny thing, how did they get in? He's a Make-A-Wish kid. So just brilliant.
I love the fact that Miguel just played along with it, like he's dying.
Yeah. The whole change in his character. He was like,
That's how you know they're real best friends. Like you when you gotta follow your friend's play, you just go with it, right? Like, you know, kind of stuff. And then the guy felt guilty. He's like, dude, he's dying.
Yeah.
He's dying. I mean, let him at least rock out one more time, you know?
Yeah.
So, that was so brilliant.
So well done. So well written, man. They're at the concert, and all of a sudden, how does he...
Hold on. I just got to talk about this real quick before we get to the whole concert thing. Okay. When Miguel was trying to reach his phone back in the hospital.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And then, like, you know, Sensei Johnny, you know, like, pushed the phone away, like, and put it on the table, pushed it away. Go get it! And then he fell to the ground, and he goes, oh, well, you felt like a champion. That's another t-shirt right there. You felt like a champion.
Yeah. Just support there, though. Like, I'm going to be here for you, whatever. Right. I just love some of those lines.
Yes.
I'm going to be here for you. You're going to go
through
it.
Your battle is not my battle. Mm-hmm. Your battle is not my battle, and I'm going to be here every single step of the way. Now, let's go back to the rock concert. They're, you know, because, Miguel's mom said, I don't care about if he never walks again. I just want him to smile again.
Yeah.
That's a mom right there, right? That's the mom, right? And so he takes her to this rock. He takes him to this rock. He's having the time of his life. I don't promote underage drinking, though, but they were having the time of his life. And then next thing you know, what happened? Go ahead, bring it out, brother. What happened?
So they had a few cervezas, but it's D fucking Snyder. Excuse my language, but it's D fucking Snyder. I Want to Rock is an anthem.
Yes.
It's an anthem. I'm old as hell. Y'all new generation may not know about it, but y'all gonna fucking know, because I Want to Rock is just, I don't give a fuck who you are. When you want to rock, you want to rock, and that's the song for it. And so obviously, he's rocking out, and he looks down, or Johnny notices it, looks down at the foot. It's tapping away, man. That was just so, again, Jeff's Kiss. Beautiful.
Beautiful
feel that song. It's a feel type, it's a music that gets you hype. And it came in it. And I just love that moment, man. That was great.
I just love that moment, especially. And then now it's really cemented.
Yep.
The 80s music is the best because he made a guy walk again. I'm a product of the 90s, but 80s music was 80s rock music was definitely rock on. Okay.
Definitely for rock. 80s for rock. I'm with you 100%. Yeah.
So, I mean, it brought this guy to walk again. So, hey, it's really great. It's really great.
So to wind down episode 5, because we're actually getting long, I think we're going to have this, our breakdown be 2 different episodes, because we got 6 through 10 to go through, and we're already an hour long with this part 1 of the season. So we're going to give you 2 parts, guys.
Right.
So to finish up episode 5, we get Johnny getting on Facebook, which is hilarious because, again, he's so out of date, so out of touch. He gets a friend request from Allie with an I and accepts the friend request. Super dope. We'll break that down again in the next coming episodes. And as we stated earlier, Amanda, who's Amanda LaRusso, the wife of Daniel, confronts Kreese and slaps him at the Cobra Kai dojo. And Mia, as you said earlier, what? Just the cojones. It just made me love her character even more. We saw her character get built up. So what do you think of the first 5 episodes before we, you know, get into the next 5?
I think it's awful. I think it's terrible. Okay. Because they only have 10 episodes.
I know,
need more. And then I look, Netflix, again, thank you for releasing it a week earlier on January 1st. And of course, because I was in the West Coast, the best coast, It came out on my midnight, not like 3 a.m. for some people here. kind of so thank you for that. But you're gonna make me wait another year,
dude.
I mean,
yeah,
that is my thing too.
With this, I echo you as well. I'm happy we can binge it, we get it all, but now,
like, what am I gonna do for the rest of the 364 days left of the year?
Yeah, exactly. That, so I'm kind of like, I love that Netflix does that. Well, they developed that binge culture for us. You got to give it to Netflix. They developed this where they, here you go. Here it is, all of it. But there is something to be said with making you wait.
Yeah.
Extending it out. Giving you reason, giving you hope, giving you more reasons to live. You know what I'm saying? Because now I don't have a reason to live anymore. I don't.
I got to wait 364 more days.
Yeah. Like, I can't wait that long.
And then for some of the articles that I'm reading, they're going to start filming later this month.
Okay.
For season 4. So at least we know there's gonna be a season 4.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, I was a little bit scared because of COVID. Like, are they gonna stop production?
Yeah,
so they're they're gonna do their thing. So I mean, I get it. I absolutely get it. I understand, but what about mid season? I'm just saying, you know, like, you know, maybe May. I can hang out till May, June, you know, kind of stuff. But yeah, no, it was great. It was great. I mean, it answered a lot of our questions, especially Kumiko, you know, and Chosen. That was really great that they finally, we were able to close that storyline, you know. I don't understand why Yuki, I mean, I understand why, but Yukio, like, Kimiko.
Yuna.
No, Kimiko.
Kumiko.
Why she never got married.
You know? Yeah.
I mean, she made that joke, like, because nobody's ever fought to the death for me before. It's like, well, okay, that is hard. That's a hard to follow up.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I think I would have loved her to have her own family. But she was happy, and that's the thing. Maybe that's the thing. Like, she was happy. Yeah. She didn't need a family. Yeah. But, you know, it would have been nice to see her. And then, of course, Chosen doesn't have any family, you know, kind of stuff. I'm like, well, he kind of fought for the death for you because he was the one trying to kill you. So maybe he could have hooked up with her. So kind of thing.
Maybe season 4, because I want her to have love. You know what I'm saying? And now with Chosen and his redemption, I want him to have love.
I do too.
Maybe they set up the two of them. I don't know. I just want them. I want everybody to be happy.
And then, and here's, I'm going to say this right now. Season 4 prediction. Even though we're only doing the first 5 episodes right now, right? I would love when they're starting to train the two schools together, right? I would love for Chosen to come to America and train the Miyagi-Do students. I would love to see that.
I don't disagree.
I'm with you. I would love to see that. And of course, he needs somebody to ride with him in the plane, right?
Hello.
So, and now Daniel and his Amanda and meets his other girlfriend, kind of stuff. So I think that would be really, really cool. I think that would really be good. They import him to America so that he can teach these guys the upper levels of Miyagi-Do karate.
I love it. But I'm going to cut you off right there because we're going to save the rest of our stuff once we get finished with episode 6 through 10. So since we're making these part ones and part twos, why don't you tell them real quick to end this off how they can hit you up online and everything, and then come back on to hear our episode 6 through 10 review.
Right. So we're going to put up all our social media. So if you're on TikTok, it's Big Boy Screamador. In Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, FMA School. And of course, my website at www.fmaschool.com. That's where you can find me. And of course, Kuya P will be sharing his contact information.
Yes. Kuya P, AKA Patrick Michael Strange. You can follow me at the Nerds of Color, our Big Daddy site, and here at the NRW, New Release Wednesday, where nerds rule the world. And for my personals, at Strange Since 1977 and at Temple Far East, it's all in the description. My man Big Boy's going to throw it down. We got y'all. But tune in to the rest of our episode, season 3 breakdown for episodes 6 through 10, man. We appreciate y'all. Love y'all.
Happy New Year.
Yeah.